أشرقت أشرقت شمس المعاني.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم افتح علينا فتوح العارفين، ووفقنا توفيق الصالحين، وانفعنا اللهم بالقرآن والذكر الحكيم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما يقربنا منك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. قال الإمام الغزالي رضي الله تعالى عنه، page 8 in English and page 9 in the Arabic. أيها الولد لا تكن من الأعمال مفلسا ولا من الأحوال خاليا، وتيقن أن العلم المجرد لا يأخذ باليد. مثاله لو كان على رجل في برية 10 أسياف هندية مع أسلحة أخرى، وكان الرجل شجاعا وأهل حرب، فهمل عليه أسد عظيم مهيب، فما ظنك هل تدفع الأسلحة شره عنه بلا استعمالها والضرب بها؟ ومن المعلوم أنها لا تدفع إلا بالتحريك والضرب. He begins speaking about actions, and today's few advices that he gives are all about amal, working, worship, effort. He says, O disciple, be neither destitute for good deeds nor devoid of spiritual states. Have both. You should not be empty of good deeds, and neither should you be empty of spiritual states. For you can be sure, meaning be sure, that mere knowledge will not help. Knowledge without action will not help. It is as though a man in the desert had 10 Indian swords. By Indian, because at that time Indian swords were known to be of top standard, and other weapons besides, the man being brave and a warrior, and a huge terrifying lion attacked him. What is your opinion? Will the weapons repel this danger of his from him without their being used and being wielded? It is obvious they will not repel it unless drawn and wielded. That's just an example Imam Ghazali gives of a man who is brave and a man who is strong. He has weapons and he's attacked. Will the mere weapon itself help? No. He must pick up the weapon and he must strike. It's the same with ilm and amal. If there is ilm but no amal, the ilm itself is not going to benefit. We only study in order to benefit in action. Imam, as I mentioned before, Imam Dawood al-Ta'i, the student of Abu Hanifa alayhi rahma, after studying for a number of years, he asked his teacher, Imam Abu Hanifa, we have studied, now what? Abu Hanifa said, now it's time for action, for amal. He spent the rest of his life in worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, if a man studied 100,000 intellectual issues and understood them, but did not act on the strength of them, they would not be of use to him except by taking action. Or it is as though a man had a temperature and jaundice, which is treated by oxymel and barley infusion. No recovery will take place except by using them. Though thou pour 2,000 measures of wine, unless thou drink, no oblivion is thine. That's a poetry in Persian that Imam Ghazali quotes to express what he means. That if a person studied so much but did not act upon them, there's no benefit of that knowledge. If a person falls ill and does not take paracetamol, in our example, the illness is not going to go away, or the flu may not go away. And what he is saying here is not something that we don't understand. Everybody understands this, that what you're going to be judged on are your actions. Don't be empty of actions. And more so, don't be empty of states. State with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People will enter Jannah based upon the amount of actions you have performed. Your rank in Jannah will be based upon the actions that you have done. Ibn Ata'illah speaks further about this, and he says actions in itself is not the key. It is acceptance. That it may be the door of actions have been opened up for you, but not the door of acceptance. The first step, however, is for amal. If there's no amal, there's nothing that you're going to be accounted upon. We have many wishful thinkers. Sayyidina Shaykh Muhammad Al-Yaqubi, Hafizahullah Ta'ala, mentions this, that people, they go to sleep in their bed, they talk about, thinking about going to become great awliya and go and do certain feats. But in actual fact, they do nothing. They're just lying there thinking, wishful thinkers. Nothing happens until you get up and do something. Right? You're not going to all of a sudden become a wali of Allah. Of course, if Allah wills, anything may happen. If He chooses, He'll enter you into his court and dominion. But truth being told is that there's no action. You're not going to be worthy of standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Ata'illah actually speaks further about actions, and he says, if it was not for the beautiful covering of Allah, our actions would not be accepted. If it was not for the covering of Allah, our actions would not be accepted. Let alone evil. He's talking about good. Even your good is not going to be accepted unless Allah covered it for you. Why? Because in order for an amal to be accepted, there are certain conditions that it must fulfill. Ikhlas to the highest level. Hudur ma'Allah, being present with Allah Ta'ala. Shuhud of Allah, witnessing Allah Ta'ala. Being solely for the sake of Allah. And most of our actions fall short. Most of our actions don't fulfill these criteria. It is because Allah, out of His generosity, covers our actions and accepts them. Some of the awliya, Allah said, they don't find anything in the dunya except the favors of Allah. مَا هُنَاكَ إِلَّا فَضْلًا. There is nothing in the dunya but favors of Allah. And we don't live but in the covering of Allah. Wallahi, all of us are covered. And I'm talking about good here, not evil. That even our good that we present in front of Allah, Allah gives us better than what we present to Him. And out of His generosity, the one who gave us tawfiq to perform the action gives, or we have hope that He will accept the action, because He is the one who initiated it. It is pure generosity from God. He made us, He made our intellect, He gave us tawfiq to perform the action. He accepts the action, although it's unworthy, then He rewards us for the action. From the beginning to the end, it's pure generosity. So the awliya say, we don't find nothing in the world but His favors. We don't live but in His covering. And then actions, you're not talking about good and bad actions. There are two types of people who seek types of covering. The person, Ibn Ata'illah says, there are two types of covering in his hikam. He says one type is a person that commits a sin. And he seeks from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala covering in that sin. He asks Allah not to show or expose him to people. Right? He seeks covering in that sin. There are others who are the special people of Allah. They seek, why do the first type seek this covering? So that they don't fall in the eyes of people. They don't fall in the eyes of people. But the higher level of the men of Allah, they seek covering from the sin itself. They don't want to be attributed with that sin. Why? Because they don't want to fall in rank in front of Allah Ta'ala. Both are seeking covering. But both are complete opposite. One is in the sin and seeking covering. Again, it's the fadl of Allah, bounty of Allah. One is seeking protection from the sin itself, so that he doesn't fall in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Looking at where people are, this is hal. This is one hal that you're in. As Imam Ghazali says, don't be free from hal. Know where you are with Allah ta'ala, what you want from Him, what you expect of Him. He is what you expect of Him, you think of Him. فَلْيَظُنَّ بِمَا شَاءَ. As the hadith could see, then let the slave think of me what he wants. You're going to come in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only thing we're going to present to Him are actions. When you leave the dunya, you leave everything behind. Your wealth, your cars, your houses, everything you own here will be owned by somebody else tomorrow. The only thing you take with you to your graves are your a'mal saliha, or your a'mal radi'ah, your good and your bad actions. Then why shouldn't the person make them his best companion? Spending time in making, pursuing good actions, so that you're able to stand in front of Allah Ta'ala. But again, it's not the good action in itself. It's truly the bounty of Allah, who initiated the good for you, who will accept the good from you, although it's not worthy of being accepted. Right? Ibn Athaillah is absolutely amazing when he speaks about subtleties in his hikam. It makes you wonder where people stand with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He then speaks about the third type of people. The third type, the first seeks protection from being exposed, so they don't fall in the eyes of people. The second seeks protection from the sin, so they don't fall in the eyes of Allah. The third, Ibn Ajiba calls them khasatul khasa, the very special people. They don't seek anything from Allah. For them, whatever comes, they're content. It's from Allah. When good comes, they see this as a manifestation of the fadl of Allah. They show happiness, contentment. When some evil emanates out of them, they realize that the wrong is theirs, but it only happened by the will of Allah Ta'ala. It reminds them of the qahr, the over-dominance of Allah Ta'ala, and they turn in abasement and humility, because that's what Allah wants to see. That's what Allah wants to see from that slave. These people, they're not concerned about what comes from God. It's how they react with regards to what comes from Allah Ta'ala. It's not that they want something. All is how they behave in front of Allah Ta'ala. Each of these are actions. The actions of the heart are probably, and for sure I would say, more powerful than the actions of the limbs, although the heart is a limb itself of what you see. There's an example of this Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was seated and he said, this man is about to come, he's a man of Jannah. A man of Jannah walking. So this Sahabi came and he just sat down, and he was like a normal person. Sat down, sat in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Of course, none of them are normal. They're all chosen to be in that company of the Messenger of Allah alayhi wa sallam. But this one Sahabi, he decided to go and accompany him to see the good in him. So he went to his home. I believe it's Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala, but I may be mistaken. And he knocks his door and says, I want to stay with you. Now, he had heard the Prophet ﷺ speak about that companion, but that companion had not heard what the Messenger of Allah said about him. So he allowed him to stay, and he stayed with him for 3 days, looking at him, observing his actions at home, at work, with his family. And 3 days he stayed with him, and after 3 days he saw nothing spectacular. So he asked him, that I've not come because I've had a fight with my father or I've got nowhere to go. It's because the Prophet ﷺ said this about you, that you're a man of Jannah. So I wanted to see what you have so that I could be like this. And the man said, I have nothing. As you've seen, I do nothing extra. The only thing that I have is that when I go to sleep, I make sure there's no hatred for anyone in the heart, for any person. I sleep without any bughd for anybody. Now that action is not seen by people, but it's seen by Allah Ta'ala. And it's accepted in the court of Allah Ta'ala. So when we say, don't be free from actions, we're not only talking about salah. We're not only talking about charity. But most actions that you perform are from your heart. Most actions of generosity, of kind. You know, the one who gives, but his heart is not willing. There's no ajr for him. Right? It's like the hadith you must have read recently, you heard about Qurbani, that the Prophet ﷺ said the most beloved thing to Allah Ta'ala in these days is hiraq al-dam, it is spilling blood. Then do it out of happiness. Because Allah loves this. Don't do it out of stinginess. Don't do it out of hatred. Don't do it out of difficulty. Don't do it because it's forced. But do it out of happiness. Allah Ta'ala loves this action. So the heart is the major player when it comes to actions. Where is your heart at that time? And the state of the heart is what Imam Ghazali is speaking about. Don't be free from actions, but don't also be free from states. States with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A state of need in front of Allah. A state of contentment with Allah. A state of reliance with Allah. A state of gratitude with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَوْ كَرَأْتَ الْإِلْمَ مِئَةَ سَنَةٍ وَجَمَعْتَ أَلْفَ كِتَابٍ لا تكون مستعدا لرحمة الله تعالى إلا بالعمل. This is a beautiful statement of Imam Ghazali. He says, even if you studied for 100 years and collected 1,000 books, you will not be eligible for the mercy of Allah except through action. مستعدا is a beautiful word. You will not be ready. You will not be worthy. You will not be eligible for the mercy of Allah without action. He doesn't mean here that the action in itself will save you. No. It means that the action is the first thing by means of which you'll be accounted. If you have good actions, there is hope for you to enter higher ranks in Jannah. Although the good in itself, the good action itself, is a good from Allah who initiated it for you. But someone who has nothing, it's like a person speaks about, or has knowledge of cars and knowledge of houses, but he has nothing in his bank balance and he goes to buy a car. He has nothing to give. Right? The money is the first key. If there's no money, you can't buy anything. It's the same with the Akhirah. What you're going to be judged upon are your actions. Every hadith that we hear about Yawm al-Qiyamah is all about actions. What did you do? How did you earn your living? How did you spend your money? How did you spend your time? Did you pray salah? If there are no actions, there's nothing to start judging people on. We say, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. Actions are by intentions. But if there's no actions, what do intentions mean? Although sometimes, some intentions are heavier than the action, even if the action is not performed. At times, it may happen that you intend something good and Allah rewards you better than the action itself. But that's from Allah Ta'ala. So, مُسْتَعِدًا لِرَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. You won't be there ready for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is to encourage people that perform good, go out of your way to do good. It doesn't mean that somebody comes on the day of judgment and he has no actions, that he will not be worthy of being forgiven or have the mercy of Allah. For we don't know, the sin we commit may be the reason Allah forgives us. The sin may be the reason we enter Jannah, because Allah wants to forgive and show His mercy. We don't know. Right? It may be the sin leads to the forgiveness of God, and the good leads to the punishment of Allah, because the good may have led to some kind of pride or some kind of independence from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Imam Ghazali is not saying that you're not going to get the mercy of Allah at all if you don't have action. But he's saying this is how you're going to be judged. And to prove this, he quotes beautiful verses. So he says, وَأَنْ لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى. Man does not receive other than what he strives. You only get what you have striven for. فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. He then who hopes for the meeting with his Lord, let him perform righteous actions. Righteous actions allow you to enter into the high stations. Ibn Ajiba, one of the greatest commentators, Shadhili Awliya Allah, recent, and also commentator on the Hikam of Imam Ibn Ata'illah, he speaks about seeking covering. And he says, why do the awliya Allah or the special people seek covering from the sin itself, not to be acquainted or attributed to the sin? He says, because those who commit sins are showing bad adab with Allah, because Allah told you not to do that thing. And those who have bad adab with their beloved, they're always taken to the door. They're asked to leave. You don't want to leave the presence of Allah Ta'ala. You don't want to be exited out. But to come in, there are certain requirements. You have to be performing actions like the people who are there. There's an example of Imam Sufyan, I believe, Thawri, one of the greatest muhaddithun and walis of the time of the Salaf. Somebody took his clothes for barakah. And he said to them, not denying barakah, but to show to them the reality. He said, even if you take my skin, it won't benefit you until you don't perform what I perform. You don't do actions that I do. It's worship that makes you come worthy of being in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what Allah has judged us for. He has told us to come forth with good, you come forth with good. But in reality, the mercy of Allah prevails. As the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, nobody will avoid Jahannam and enter Jannah but by the rahmah of Allah. Sayyidah Aisha said, radiallahu ta'ala anha, Ya Rasulullah, even you also, he said, even me. If it was not for the mercy of Allah, we wouldn't be where we are. It is the mercy of Allah Ta'ala that envelops everybody, encompasses everyone. From the mercy is that He gives tawfiq for you to do good. But as humans, we've got a duty with Allah Ta'ala to try to show good actions in the court of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. The next verse he quotes, جَزَاءً بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. They shall get reward for what they used to do, meaning the good that they do. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ كانت لهم جنات الفردوس نزلا خالدين فيها لا يبغون عنها حولا. Verily those who believe and do righteous deeds will have gardens of paradise to dwell in forever, whence they will not seek change. And you find this in the Quran. How many times Allah speaks about iman, He will couple it with amal salihah. Amal salihah. Amanu wa amil salihat. They believe and they do good, righteous actions. Don't be free of them. Allah give tawfiq, that He gives us all tawfiq to have many of them when we come on Yawm al-Qiyamah. فَخَلَفَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ No, I missed a page out. فَخَلَفَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ أَضَاءُ الصَّلَاةَ وَاتَّبَعُوا الشَّهَوَاتِ فَسَوْفَ يَلْقُونَ غَيًّا إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَأُولَئِكَ يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ وَلَا يُظْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا He quotes another verse. Descendants have replaced them who neglected prayer and followed passions. They shall come to perdition except for those who repent and believe and act righteously, for these will enter the garden and not be harmed at all. وَمَا تَقُولُ فِي هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ Now Imam Ghazali speaking to his student, what do you say about this hadith? بُنِيَ الْإِسْلَامُ عَلَىٰ خَمْسِ Islam is based upon five things. شَهَادَةِ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهُ وَإِقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِيتَاءِ الزَّكَاةِ وَصَوْمِ رَمَضَانَ وَحَجِّ الْبَيْتِ لِمَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا What do you say regarding this tradition? Islam is based on five things. Testimony that there is no God but Allah, and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, keeping up the formal prayer, paying alms, the fast of Ramadan, and the pilgrimage to the house for whoever is capable of the journey. What Imam Ghazali is expressing here is that the whole of religion is based upon action. Testimony in itself is an action of the tongue. Everything is action. It's actions that make you enter the highest stations of Jannah, or actions that make you fall to the lowest abodes of the lowest pits of the fire. والإيمان قول باللسان والتصديق بالجنان وعمل بالأركان ودليل الأعمال أكثر من أن يحصى وإن كان العبد يبلغ الجنة بفضل الله تعالى وكرمه لكن بعد أن يستعد بطاعته وعبادته لأن رحمة الله قريب من المحسنين Imam Ghazali then says, first, faith is verbal declaration, consent by the heart and action in accordance with the five pillars. Similar to what the Mu'tazila have said regarding the definition of faith. But in truth, we also believe the same, that love without obedience is mere claim. Love without obedience is mere claim. Faith without action is empty. You believe in Allah, then you come forth with what He has asked you to do. So we're not saying let's believe in Allah not do good, as it may have been formed in Aqidah, but rather we say it's not a part of Aqidah. But of course, the sign of your iman, the strength of your iman, is how much good you do. And the evidence of deeds is incalculable. Imam Ghazali says that you can't count the evidences that have been suggested about performing good. Even though the worshipper attains paradise by the bounty and grace of Allah, nevertheless, consequent to his being predisposed through obedience to Him and worship of Him, since the mercy of Allah is near to those who do good. So he himself states here that in truth, you only enter Jannah out of the bounty of Allah Ta'ala. But it is people that do good who are the true recipients of the bounty of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. Although we have hope in Allah, that even sins that we may have may be a means of great forgiveness. As the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, my shafa'ah is for the great sinners of my ummah. My shafa'ah is for the great sinners of my ummah. You have great sins, you have hope in the shafa'ah of the Prophet ﷺ. But do we live a life like this? No. You behave the way Allah wants you to behave, performing righteous actions, always maintaining good opinion of people. وَلَوْ قِيلَ أَيْضًا it is also said, يَبْلُغُ بِمُجَرَدِ الْإِيمَانِ قُلْنَا نَعَمْ لَكِنْ مَتَى يَبْلُغُ وَكَمْ مِنْ عَقَبَةٍ كَأُودٍ يَقْتَعُهَا إِلَىٰ أَنْ يَصِلْ If moreover it is said, so Imam Ghazali is posing a question to himself, he gets there by faith alone, that a man will enter Jannah by faith alone. We reply, yes, but when will he get there? How many difficult obstacles must he overcome before arriving to Jannah? The for sure iman, as the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and qala la ilaha illallah dakhal al jannah. Whoever says la ilaha illallah will enter Jannah. Or the hadith, whoever has the smallest amount of faith, even to the amount of an atom, he will enter Jannah. So belief will make you enter Jannah. That's what's the entry requirement. But Imam Ghazali is speaking further, okay, for sure. But it may be after a very long time. It may be after punishment. Probably the most for some people, inshaAllah, is that the displeasure of Allah comes upon people. More than the punishment of God, is that there is displeasure from Him. Because you didn't behave like you ought to have behaved. or if there are punishments or there are obstacles, how long would it take before a person reaches Jannah? Just the day itself of reckoning in itself is too difficult for a person to stand there without the shade that Allah provides. We're talking about a day which is 50,000 years long. And we're talking about standing in this heat before the accounting begins. The whole of mankind together, where they're naked and they're sweating according to the amount of sin they have. And only a few types of people will be in security under the shade that the shade Allah provides. From them are people that would give in the right hand, the left hand would not know. People that would come to the masjid and pray, and their heart would remain attached in the masjid. People that would sit alone, and their eyes would become wet with tears out of remembrance of Allah Ta'ala. You know, are we amongst these people? That 50,000 years is an amount of time that we can't calculate. Really, you start counting. 50,000 is very long. And that's, forget punishment. That's mere standing in front of Allah until humanity will go to Adam alayhi salam, to Ibrahim alayhi salam, to Musa, to Isa, until they come to the Prophet alayhi salam, and he will come in front of Allah and fall into sajda, and Allah will then say, "Oh Muhammad, raise your head, ask, it'll be given, and intercede, and it'll be accepted." Then the accounting will begin. The mere accounting, the scales will be brought out, the angels will come forth, heaven and hell will be shown. We're not even talking about punishment. The mere standing under that heat, where the sun is a mile and a quarter above the head, if we could avoid just that and be in the shade of Allah, you've been successful. But let's say our actions are not such that we're unable to stand in the shade of Allah. Are we able to bear that standing in front of Allah, which is not even considered to be a punishment? We can't. How will a man be able to stand under the shade of Allah? By action. If he performs those actions that are beloved to Allah, he will then give you honor and place you at... On Yawm al-Qiyamah, there will be people that will be completely free from what's going on. They won't feel anything. Clear hadith that they'll be protected on that day. They'll be standing or seated on... They'll be wearing robes and seated on thrones and on high ladders, where even Anbiya and Shuhada will be envious of them. Good envy. How did a person who's not a Nabi reach this maqam on the day of judgment? How will a person reach this maqam? Through action. If there's no action, there's nothing you've got to present in front of Allah. And most actions are by the heart. Most actions which make you reach the high stations are by the heart. Purify the heart. Read the works and accounts of the awliya, because reading their lives makes you feel or brings out a yearning that you want to be like them. It gives you impotence to work and behave like them. One of the awliya, as Fariduddin Attar mentions in his Tazkiratul Awliya at the beginning, as to why he wrote this work, accounts of the awliya, he said one of the awliya passed away. He was seen in a dream and he was asked, how did you fare with Allah? And the wali said, I was only forgiven because of me narrating accounts of the awliya which left flames or ignited flame in the heart of the believer to become like them. They had hope in Allah. I want to become like this wali. I want to do these actions. The fact that I was able just to do this, to narrating the accounts, Allah forgave me. Because I put into their hearts love for His awliya to be like them. Right? Reading accounts of awliya Allah, that's why Imam Kushairi begins from the rijal of this path. So you come to see what these people were like, how they lived their lives. And it's all is by action. You don't find any one of them who didn't pray their prayers, or who didn't do tahajjud, or didn't do qiyamul layl, or wouldn't give in the way of Allah. Men always worshipped, and they never felt content with their worship. They would always fear the last moment. And they would say, like Abdul Qadir al-Jilani, al-Ghawf al-A'zam would say, that he's not safe until his last breath. It's only then that is guaranteed. You know, one of the last words of Shaykh Abdul Qadir al-Jilani was victory. His last words were victory after the Shahada. Why? He felt my life is gone, the last breath is to be taken, and I've gone with Iman. Only then he uttered these words, victory. But he's victorious against Shaitan, his nafs, and to come in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're talking about people like Imam Junaid, who worshipped all their lives, right at their deathbed. People ask him, how are you? And he said, I feel like a leaf in wind. I don't know which way Allah is going to take me. Towards Jannah, His pleasure, or towards Jahannam. All of my actions have gone away. It just all disappeared. There's nothing. I've just got hope in Allah that remains. But it was actions that made him reach such a maqam. It's like that wali who stayed awake for 40 years, worshipping Allah, after 40 years he fell asleep. In that sleep he saw the vision of Allah Ta'ala, of course without form. So he thought to himself, but sleep made me reach this. The answer was given is because you stayed awake 40 years that you had this sleep which gave you this vision. That you were worthy of being such that you see Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala in your dreams. Shaykh Muhammad says this, hafizahullah wa ta'ala, that if you want to be a wali, you're making a claim. Then do actions, perform actions like they performed. You can't be expected to sit at home, be lazy in front of the TV, you know, shouting at family members, arguing, have no sabr on basic food, or the food is delayed, and then you expect to become a wali when you come to the masjid. It doesn't happen that you just all of a sudden are going to become a great wali of Allah. But if there's true effort, although the effort is short, Allah Ta'ala, out of His favor and bounty, raises people and includes you amongst His awliya. And then Allah gives that sweetness of iman, which Imam Ghazali mentioned in the beginning, that don't be free from hal. Don't be free from hal. Have states with Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. You'll be in different states. Sometimes you're in a state of complete dependence of God. Sometimes you come into a state when you become completely independent from people. Sometimes you come into a state that wherever you look, you always see Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. You're reminded of Allah at all times. And this only comes when there's sincerity in heart, when there's an effort. But again, all of these actions come back to the favor and the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want you to see the last few lines and then we'll stop. Because I think the next nasiha begins. He then says, فَأَوَّلُ تِلْكَ الْعَقَبَاتِ عَقَبَةُ الْإِيمَانِ وَأَنَّهُ هَلْ يَسْلَمُ مِنْ سَلْبِ الْإِيمَانِ أَمْ لَا. He says, and the very first of these obstacles is that of faith itself. Will he be safe from the denial of faith or not when he arrives? Meaning you're talking about people saying, okay, I'm going to enter by mere faith. The first obstacle Imam Ghazali mentions is, do you even know that you're going to leave the world with iman? Al-Hasan al-Basri said, God the Exalted will say to his worshippers on the day of resurrection, O worshippers of mine, enter the garden by my mercy and divide it between you according to your deeds. And you come to certain ranks because of your actions. But you really enter because of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we know from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Imam Ghazali says that there are too many, the door of Rayyan, for example, you know, in Jannah has 8 doors, and one is called Rayyan, and nobody enters it but the one who fasts often. How does a person enter these doors? It's through actions, not through mere words, not through hope. You know, people, as the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he who spent his life wishfully thinking, Allah is merciful, Allah is merciful, and didn't perform actions, he's destroyed his life. It's going to come. But he who performed actions, prepared for the meeting with Allah, but then left it with Allah Ta'ala, is the one who's going to be successful. As the next hadith, I believe Imam Ghazali is going to come forth with. So inshallah, Allah give tawfiq that we come to realize actions speak louder than words. It's what comes and is presented in the court of Allah. But even then we don't rely upon actions. What we rely upon is the favor of Allah, who accepts our actions although we're not worthy of them. Imam Ibn Ata'illah, just the last point, we'll stop there. He says this, that if you come to realize that you've got shortcomings, but Allah Ta'ala, out of His generosity, turns people to you because of the good that emanates out of you, and they praise you, Ibn Ajiba then says, now ask, who's really being praised, you or the one who covered you? It's the one who covered you. Then Ibn Ata'illah says that when somebody honors you, they don't really honor you. They're honoring the one who covered you. Praise be to the one who covered you. You know, we live, wallahi, in the covering of Allah. Everyone, from the lowest of people, meaning those who commit sins, to the best of people. Everyone lives in the covering of Allah Ta'ala. And we have this much hope, knowledge with Allah, your heart starts becoming a bit softer, a bit more acceptable with the dunya, that you have shortcomings, but Allah covered me, Allah gave me iman, Allah gave me this, Allah gave me that. You live with Him. Allah give tawfiq. I'll stop here inshaAllah. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Which is better, praying tahajjud or staying awake after fajr till sunrise doing dhikr? Assuming one struggles to do both. So that's the answer I was going to give. Tahajjud is better. Performing Qiyamul Layl is the best optional worship from Nawafil that a man may be able to perform. So getting Qiyamul Layl into your routine is one, the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and the best worship that you could perform with a lot of secrets that come at that time. And if you're able to stay awake, then fine, until sunrise, alhamdulillah. But try your best to get some Qiyamul Layl. For brothers and sisters, see, the difference between brothers and sisters is the males in the Hanafis are expected to pray in Jama'ah. Right? So the Jama'ah in the Hanafis tends to be late. Right? So you'd be expected to wake up for Tahajjud, Qiyamul Layl, do some worship, sleep, stay awake, and then go for Jama'ah. Because sisters, for their mustahab time is as soon as Fajr comes in. If Fajr comes in at 5 a.m., they should wake up 5 minutes before 5 a.m., 10 minutes, do wudu, get two nafal in, and then do the Fajr straight after. So you've got your Qiyamul Layl and you've got your Fajr. And if you maintain this practice, even brothers who can't attend Jama'ah because of distance or work, slowly you get into the routine of praying Nawafil and Qiyamul Layl in the night. All of a sudden changes, becomes very difficult. And if you've got wird to do, you do that after Fajr. For sisters, it's very easy then, inshallah. Qiyamul Layl, a minute later Fajr Salah, a minute later Dhikr, go back to sleep. For brothers, if they know, it's a struggle, really. Waking for Qiyamul Layl, then either resting or going back to sleep until Fajr Jama'ah, then going for Fajr Jama'ah, then doing the Dhikr, then sunrising, maintaining Dhikr of Allah, then the two Nafal. After, you know, it becomes quite difficult. So if you're someone like myself who's got nothing else to do, it becomes easy. But if you're someone who's got work, but work in itself is ibadah. So it's not that the one who does Qiyamul Layl and the one who does the dhikr in the mornings is doing better than the one who's gone out working, earning a livelihood. Because at that particular time, that job is more dhikr and ibadah to Allah Ta'ala than waking up in the night. Right? So everything has to be in perspective. Is how would Allah Ta'ala want you to be at that time? Not how you want to be. Right? Sometimes we fall into this self-deceit. Ibn Atayla says, I'd like to say this word as well, inshallah. It's beautiful. Ibn Atayla says, the one who performs worship to Allah is more in need of the pardon of Allah than the one who commits a sin. The one who does worship of Allah, obedient to Allah, is more in need of the pardon of Allah than the one who commits a sin. He says, why? Because when you perform good actions, you raise yourself in the eyes of people. People look towards you, honor you. And you come towards izzah, rifa'a, you know, maqam, high ranks and stations, and slowly kibra creeps into the heart, pride. Or if not kibra, then istighna, you start feeling independent from everything. You start feeling, yes, I'm righteous, I'm good. And coming to Allah with such a state is disgusting. Because you are an abd. Abd means literally someone who's low, who's very humble. Whereas if you commit a sin, the eyes of people turn away from you. Nobody wants to know you. The only door left for you is Allah. So when you turn to Allah, you turn with abasement, you turn with sincerity. So Allah forgives. But the one who comes to Allah with good, thinking he is good, he needs more of the mercy of Allah than the one who's committed the sin. Allah give tawfiq, inshallah. He accepts us the way we are. وَصَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ اجْمَعِينَ.